In the Bible, when women experience miracles, are they ever not to do with babies? Let's find out. Hey there, Christy here, and in today's video, I want to do the third part of this three-part series that examines Yahweh's interaction with women. I think a few years ago, Bill Maher had a new rule that women were no longer able to complain about men until they got better taste in them. Now, other than the fact that that logic goes in both directions, I think it is worth considering women who follow Yahweh and whether or not this is a God that respects women. And the only way to discover that is to not only look at the text says about women and how women should be treated, but let's actually look at what the text presents Yahweh doing. Personally, when I look at the text, what I see is contempt for women, women that are all but invisible, except when it comes for time to discuss sex, babies, virginities, prostitution, and rape. In other words, the Bible isn't so much concerned about women as people, but the vaginas and the people attached to those vaginas. To demonstrate this emphasis on women's reproduction rather than as people, I looked in my last video at whether or not Yahweh talked directly to women and about what. In this video, I'm going to be looking at the miracles associated with Yahweh in the first five books of the Bible and whether or not there are any that are not around pregnancy or babies. In this analysis, I've searched the first five books for any interaction between women and either angelical messengers or dreams or direct contact with Yahweh, and everything that is called a miracle or is attributed to Yahweh, I am going to take at face value and count as a miracle. In my analysis, I can't find an instance where Yahweh performs a miracle that isn't around a woman's sort of fertility or her children. And I'm not a Bible expert. You know, I did this by just going on to the searches and looking inside the text and going through all of the instances where I saw women in the first five books, which is really just in Genesis and maybe a little bit in Numbers. And I can't find any evidence that there are non-baby related miracles in the first five books. Of course, like I said, I'm not an expert, and maybe I've forgotten one or you're aware of one that, you know, I've overlooked. And if that's the case, please put your information in the D box below, and I'll do an errata video if there's a lot of them I've missed, or I'll do an annotation, you know, in this area if there's an obvious thing that I've missed and needs correction. But if there's nothing here, then nobody said anything yet. As in the last video, most of these instances of miracles are found in Genesis, although I did find one in Exodus, and I couldn't find anything in the other three books of the Bible. The instances of miracles that I found are Eve, Sarah, Hagar, Rebecca, Leah, Rachel, and the Hebrew midwives of Exodus. So shall we go over them one by one? Eve has two miracle interactions. In Genesis 4:1, she says, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord, and that's when she bore Cain. And then in Genesis 4:25, it reads, Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son and called his name Seth. For she said, God has appointed for me another child instead of Abel, for Cain slew him. So Eve got two miracle babies, but that seems to be all that happened to her in terms of her life and her interactions with Yahweh. The second instance is with Sarah, and that's at Genesis 21:2. The Lord visited Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Just as a little note, I think it's quite interesting here that in this passage, the Lord visits Sarah directly, and he does to Sarah as he promised. But in the New Testament, it's an angel that visits Eve to impregnate her with the Holy Spirit. So there's no direct appearance by the Lord. He does show up to impregnate, artificially inseminate, or whatever work his magic for Sarah. He does that in person, but he doesn't go for his own child. Doesn't that seem a bit weird to you? Anyway. Hagar had a miracle interaction with an angel of Yahweh, and this is perhaps a fuzzy one because if you'll see that it's not really Hagar who attracts the attention of God, it's her child, but I'm going to count it anyway because, to be honest, he needs the handicap. So Genesis 21, I'm not sure the passage is here. It looks like around 18 or 17 it starts. And as she sat over him, the child lifted up his voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel called Hagar from the heavens and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift the lad up and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make him a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water, and she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink. So there is God performing a miracle, really to, you know, save, responding to the child, but he's interacting with the mother. The next instance I could find was Rebekah, Genesis 25:21. And Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his prayer, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. Again, this is a little bit dodgy because, you know, it's a man, it's not a direct interaction, you know, he's a man is praying for something, and then Yahweh is performing a miracle for the woman. We saw that last time again with the child, where there's a male intermediary. But again, he is sort of directly interfering with her body and making her pregnant. So I'm going to count this as an interaction. Then we have the baby off. For those of you who are not deeply familiar with the Bible, there's a really great passage, great in terms of like entertainment value, where Leah and Rachel are, who are both married to Jacob, want to keep having his baby. So they're both trying to get pregnant over and over again. And when they can't do it, they hand over their servant girls or slave girls to their husband and presumably steal their babies and raise them as their own. That's never really explained, and it's quite troubling. But they just basically have an entire section where it's about having a competitive baby birthing, which is just insane. Because of this competitive baby birthing, Leah gets four miracles. In Genesis 29:31, when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. Genesis 29:32, and Leah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Reuben, for she said, "Because the Lord has looked upon my affliction, surely now my husband will love me." Genesis 29:33, she conceived again and bore a son, and said, "Because the Lord has heard that I am hated, he has given me the son also." And she called his name Simeon, I think. And finally, Genesis 30:17, and God hearkened to Leah, and she conceived and bore Jacob, a fifth son. So really, I mean, of all the women, Yahweh must have really liked Leah's womb, because he made a lot of things happen there. Rachel gets two, but she gets a negative and a positive. So the first one is a negative miracle, Genesis 30:2. Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel, and he said, "Am I in the place of God, who has withheld from you the fruit of your womb?" And Genesis 30:22. Then God remembered Rachel. Oh yeah, Rachel. And hearkened to her and opened her womb. She conceived and bore a son and said, "God has taken away my reproach." So there you go, baby delivery. But God's got to remember it first. That was it for all of the Genesis interactions in terms of women and miracles. I know we got through that pretty quick, didn't we? And the only one that I can find in Exodus has to do with the Hebrew midwives. And in this case, God doesn't do a miracle for a particular woman. He does it for just sort of women, a generic group of women as a reward, I guess. I'll read the passage and then we can discuss. In the story, this is the slaughtering of the infants, where the king of Egypt is saying to the Hebrew midwives that they should be killing the children, the male children that are born to the Hebrew women, and they don't, and they lie to the king of Egypt instead and tell them that the women are too vigorous and they're having their babies before they can get the birthing stool there. And because they lied, the passage says, "So God dealt well with midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families." I'm interpreting this to mean that he intervenes supernaturally in order to make them pregnant and, you know, give them fecundity. The first book of the Bible, the J source, scholars estimate, was written in about 950 BCE. And the last texts, the priestly source writers, were writing around 500 BCE. That's 450 years of stories and myths and traditions to build up. Now, if we went back 450 years from today, that would have been 1565. That's when the Spanish were founding St. Augustine, Florida. Sir Walter Raleigh's Roanoke Island was being founded. And in Europe, the Spanish Armada was had the great defeat or the disastrous results in its campaign to attack England. So if you imagine that amount of time, right, going back 450 years, and if we took all of the writings since that period forward, what if we only found a handful of instances of women in all of those writings? To me, it says something about the values of the culture and society, that women weren't worth talking about, weren't worth recording, weren't worth paying attention to. And that's pretty much what I see in these texts. So if Yahweh spoke to, you know, three women directly and performed, let's say, less than, you know, a dozen or so miracles for women over 450 years, and all of them are baby-based, what does this really tell us about the values of the God that monotheists are worshiping? I would hope that men, but especially women, would ask themselves these questions and ask whether or not the Bible is really a good source for finding our gender roles and our gender norms, or if it's time to set it aside because it doesn't reflect our values. So this is it for the series. Next week, I'm going to change it up. I'm looking to do an interview, but I'm going to tell you a bit more about that later on. Trying out some new things with this break from my History of God series. It's really nice to sort of stretch out and try out other things. I'm enjoying it. I mean, I'm going to get back to Karen, but this has been a lot of fun, and I've been enjoying this time off quite a lot, and I hope that you guys are seeing the results of my enjoyment. So next week is going to be something a little bit different, but I'll tell you more later when it's all come together. Until then, I've been Christy. You have been awesome, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.